Hello everybody, great to see so many people here in the room. I'm really surprised how many people are interested in the whole topic about decentralizing the internet, and also how many people stay still in front of the door and want to come in. That's really amazing that so many people are interested in this whole topic and all the stuff we discuss here the whole day. That's really amazing. My name is Björn. I work at OwnCloud and Nextcloud at the moment, but I started at OwnCloud already 3 years ago. To think about how cloud federation could work, how we could set up clouds which works together in a decentralized way. And then we developed this with OwnCloud, and then I went over to Nextcloud, where we developed this further. And I just want to present you how all this works, what we already have today, and especially also what's our plan for the future, where we want to go move to. Did someone already use OwnCloud or Nextcloud here in the room? And you already tried to use the federated sharing feature? Oh, okay, quite some people. That's really nice. So just some introduction. As you know, the internet as it started at the beginning, it was all decentralized. Everybody could set up his own web server or his email server, and they could all communicate with each other. But then at some point in time, we entered the dark age of the internet, how I would call it, where we moved to more and more centralized servers. And if you look a few years back, or honestly even today, if you look at the mass market, at 90% of the users, if they want to store their files and to sync them with their devices and share them, they normally go to two or three vendors which are out there, which is mainly Apple these days, Google's or Dropbox, where they put their files in there and then they can do all this stuff. And then they have, of course, all this in one centralized server, which on the one side is nice because they all, of course, know how to develop software, so there's a nice shiny interface. This works all great, and all people are there, so you can collaborate with all of them. So it looks quite nice, but of course it raises a lot of questions about privacy and who controls your data and who has access to it. So a few years ago, some projects started to develop free software cloud solutions, which everybody can host by their own and install their own cloud server to do basically the same. And I think this was a great work from all the projects out there which did this, because there appeared a lot of great software. And then people start to set up their own server, be it an own cloud server, Nextcloud server, and Pydio, and C-file, whatever you name it. And people just start to upload their files, sync their contacts and calendar with their own devices, and everything works nice. As long as they stayed on their own server or started to collaborate with the few people on the server. But especially if you think this a few steps further, for example, like projects like the Freedom Box, where we think about maybe a point in time where everybody has his small box at home, where he has all his cloud services, then the number of users on one of the services goes down to nearly one, maybe two or three, depending on how many people live in your building. And then, of course, it was really fast. We get in the situation that you want to share with someone a file or want to collaborate with someone, but he's not on your server at home, but he has his own server. And so the question is, how can you collaborate with these people in a way that it as good integrated and as seamless as if the user would be on the same server? So that's the challenge. And that's where we came up with the idea of Cloud Federation, where we said, okay, we need a protocol, a way to create a bridge between the servers so that a user on one server can share with a user on another server and work with him together on some files or collaborate. And for the user, it should be completely transparent. For the user, it shouldn't matter if the user of the other user is on the same server or a different server. To achieve this, we have invented the idea of a federated cloud ID, which looks quite similar to an email address, because we thought, okay, that's most people are familiar with, they know how to handle it, how it looks like. So it's basically the user of on your cloud server, and then add the URL of your next cloud server. And then we developed some REST API, which is quite small. It's just 4 to 5 calls, basically, where you can send and share invitation to a different cloud server, and then he can accept or decline it, and then you have a request to unshare it or to change permissions or send a notification. But it's a really small API, easy to implement. And once this invitation is accepted, once a user on the other server accepted your share, then we create a normal WebDAV mount. For us, it was really important at Nextcloud all the time that we don't want to reinvent the wheel. So whenever there is a standard already out there, which is also widely used, we try to use it, because I think that's the best way to make it available to many people on different projects. So we choose WebDAV, even if we know, especially for syncing and stuff like this, it has some limitations, but we thought that's the widely used standard and most easy to implement for most of the people. And as I said, we don't want to create the next island, right? If this would be only implemented with Nextcloud, then of course then all the Nextcloud could work with each other or all the own clouds, but we would still generate an island. The island would be just bigger. It would be the island of all the Nextclouds or all the own clouds, and you could interoperate across these different cloud solutions. So for us it was always really important to also implement this in as many solutions as possible. So at the moment, as of today, no matter if you have installed a Nextcloud server, or a Pydio server, or an own cloud server, you can do this federated sharing across all the servers between the users. It doesn't make a difference. All these three solutions already implemented it. And I just talked last week with some CFI developers, which are also really interested in this. So the chance exists that in maybe in 1 year or something, this will also work together with CFI. So let me show some screenshots and explain how this works, also a little bit historically, because we moved from a simple implementation and then advanced it over time. This all started with the idea Nextcloud always had these public links. If you want to share with someone outside of your Nextcloud, you could create a public link and then put it in an email or something and send it to someone, and then the person could open the link in the browser and access the file or the folder you shared with him. And then our first step was said, okay, if you send someone such a link, then add an add to your Nextcloud button at top of it. If the user also has a Nextcloud, he can click the add to your Nextcloud button, enter his cloud ID, and then in the first version, it was then just directly created in WebDAV mount from this file to the other user's Nextcloud. So that then it was seamlessly integrated in his Nextcloud file listing, his sync client started to sync it, and it was already a great step forward to what we want to achieve. Then in the next iteration, we changed this a little bit to not create this WebDAV mount directly. But nowadays, if you do this at least on Nextcloud, it's not implemented in OwnCloud in Pydio yet, but on Nextcloud, if you go on this, open a public link and add your cloud ID, then we don't create this public WebDAV mount directly, but then we ask the server from the file, please make a federated share with the other user on the other server. This has many advantages. One is that the owner of the file can keep track who has mounted his public link to his Nextcloud, because in his share list he will then see all the people who clicked this add to my Nextcloud button and mount it. So then the owner of the file can control the permissions, for example, which permissions the different people have on the file, and can remove one of these mounts again. So this makes it already way nicer to integrate. And of course, the next step, we didn't want that people first have to send around this public link and then people can add to Nextcloud. So the next step was to integrate this in the share dialog we have in Nextcloud. If you are logged in, you have a dialog where you can share with internal users and group, where you just type in the name, and then you have also have nice auto-completion, and then you share with your user on the same server. And there we allowed now to also type in the federated cloud ID, like you would type in a local user, and then the file gets shared to the user on the other server. And again, you have then your listing with the people who have access to the file, all the people, also the internal people and the external people, and can control all the permissions and revoke the access again and stuff like this. This works quite nicely, except for one thing. Group shares at the moment are not possible. But we are also thinking about how we can solve this problem, that you can also address a group on another server, so that if you want to share with a working group, which is on a different server, you don't have to share it by one by every person in the group, but you can also address the group directly on this other server and share with the group. Another problem, at this point it already worked quite nicely and was quite integrated, but another big problem was always how to find people, because to share with someone I need to know the federated cloud ID. And there we thought about many different things, also partly some stuff which was just discussed before me in the Matrix talk. I think we made a think about quite similar problems, and maybe it also makes sense to discuss this and see if we can maybe even have a common solution for this. One first step we did, and which is already implemented for quite some time in Nextcloud and OwnCloud, and Pydio now also implements it at the moment, is the concept of trusted servers. So this was a request from mainly research institutes, which has many Nextcloud installations on different institutes. And if people want to work together, they wanted somehow have them in the share dialog, auto-completion of all the people, no matter if, on which cloud they are. So there, the administrator of the Nextcloud server can add trusted servers, which they know, for example, they are in the same research institute or in the same department or the same university. These are the servers I trust. And if the other admins adds the same server, then they start to exchange an authentication token and then use this to synchronize the user lists. So then all trusted servers know the users from the other trusted servers, and then you can find them in your auto-completion and share seamlessly with them. And if you want to go one step further, you can also enable it that whenever you create a federated share successfully with a user on a different server, then your server automatically adds the server to your list of trusted servers. That's basically the idea that as soon as you have created one valid share with a user on another server, then you can somehow assume that the other server is not a completely spam server or a completely stupid server, but then there are users which are really valid users you want to work with. So if you want, you can enable it, and then this has then your network of trusted server basically grows over time, and you will know more and more people you can share with. Then we wanted to take this one step further. That's what we implemented now, just recently, a few weeks ago, with Nextcloud 11, and we want to move this forward with Nextcloud 12 in a few months. And this is some kind of a global address book. So we extended the profile page of the user you have in your Nextcloud, where you can not only add your full name and your email address, but you can also use all the other stuff you need, you know, from context, like your phone number, your address, your Twitter handle, your website, and stuff like this. And then we allow you to define the visibility of all of this information. By default, of course, everything is private, so nothing happens, it's just there for you. But you can decide to set it either to context, this means that it will sync with the trusted servers of your Nextcloud, or you can set it to public. And if you set it to public, it will sync to a global address book server, which is the same as at Matrix at the moment, centralized, and we are looking in ways how to solve this problem. But then your data are published, the data you want to make public are published on the server together with your cloud ID, and then people again can find you and share with you. And we want to use the Twitter handle and the website, we want to use to do there some verification, a little bit similar like Keybase, that you can sign your presence there, and then you can verify that the person is really the person you want to share with. But of course, we also need to think further, like ideas like, or also verify your email address, your phone number, as said in the talk before, would be really interesting to verify. But that's not that easy problems to solve, as you may already guess when you heard the last talk. So our next step is that we want to move from the central server over to a federated server, so that you can set up your own Nextcloud. Everybody can set up his own address book server and then configure in his Nextcloud to which server you want to contact, which server you want to contact if you have a request. And therefore, basically we have two ideas. One, we think if we look at big customers at Nextcloud, big companies or research institutes, they might want to have just one lookup server or address book in their institute, which all their Nextclouds connect to, but which doesn't federate to the outside. Or it's completely valid that you just find the people in your own organization, or you can decide that you are be part of the global network and federate with all the other servers out there and exchange the data. So how we thought in the first step, how we solved the problem that we authenticate user and make sure that you share with the right person. At Nextcloud already every person, every account has a private public key attached to it. So our idea at the moment is that before we send the data to this address book, we could sign it with the private key. And then a valid address book server would only accept updates from this from the user if he changed his email address or if he changed something. Only an update would be accepted if it's still signed again with the same same private key. And you could at the same time use the Twitter and homepage verification to also make sure that the data set is signed with the same key, like the homepage and the Twitter account and stuff like this. And to exchange these public keys, we just thought about to do some kind of trust on first contact, because we thought that the time where you share the first time with a user on a different Nextcloud is quite a random timestamp, right? If someone wants to really get into this communication, it's really hard to guess when this happens, this first share. So we assume that this is relatively secure time point in time where this happens, and it, for your first share, you also are sure that you know to whom you share your files, basically. And so at the first share, when the share connection gets established, you also get a public key from this user, from his server back. So then every time you share again with this user, or every time you get an update from the address book from some data of the user, you can use the public key to verify the signature. And as long as the signature is the same, you assume, okay, it's still the same user you are in contact with, and if it changed, then you know that basically probably something happens. Either the admin of the lookup server changed something in the data, or maybe someone managed to upload some false data. So that's an idea we want to try out if it works, and just want to push this forward and see how this works at the end. So why are we doing this with this global address book? I think there are a few benefits. One, of course, it's, as I said at the beginning, it makes it way easier to find people to share with. And I think that's a big problem we all in the decentralized world have to solve. Somehow, how do you find people if they are not on the same server? And this is one approach we want to try to investigate if this is a feasible way to do it. And one thing which is also especially important for us is if this works, this would allow people to migrate from one server to another. So if you have your own Nextcloud server and you just change your domain, for example, or if you choose a Nextcloud provider and at some point in time you want to go to a different provider, you could just migrate all your data to the next provider, including your keys. And if you are on the next provider, you push an update of your data set with your new federated cloud ID, and then all the existing shares could adjust to the new cloud ID, and also the new shares you do after that could be directly end up at the right user account. Another problem we need to solve at the moment at Nextcloud is that, especially in research institutes, you often have an LDAP backend to authenticate the users, and it's quite typical that users use their email address to authenticate at the Nextcloud server. And then the cloud IDs becomes quite ugly, because then you have two @ signs in it, because at the front you have the email address with the @, and then you have another @ which refers to the server. So that's a pain we heard already for years from users that they want to solve somehow, and we thought about it and we came up with two solutions we want to implement now in Nextcloud 12. One is that we want to allow the administrator to define a pattern how the first part of the cloud ID should look like. So in this use case, an admin could just define that for every user ID, we strip the @ from the email address and the email server and just use the first user identifier and the cloud server. Or the next approach will be that we allow the user really to freely, in his profile settings, choose a complete random cloud ID, however they want it to look like. As I said, the admin approach is would be for a whole server, but he would define a pattern how to do this. And then, of course, the admin would need to take care that he doesn't create any name collisions for the cloud IDs. And the server could relatively easily resolve this. For the user part, we thought that it would be quite nice, because many users already have their email address and often use the same address also, for example, as XMPP address. So it would be really nice if you could use again the same address to also use it to share with people. So they have one unique address where you can email the people, you can chat with them, and you can share files with them. So that was the motivation of this. And there we thought, okay, if you put your own cloud ID into your profile settings, then you could put on your server, if you control the domain, either a well-known file, which does redirect to the real cloud server, or maybe even DNS entry, which does the redirection. And then if you do a federated share with this email address, basically we would just look there if there is the well-known file. If there is the well-known file, we then would make the share request to the real cloud server instead of to the local server. And the cloud server would provide an API to then resolve just this user-defined cloud IDs to the real cloud ID, which matches also the server which is out there. And of course, now I talked a lot about federated sharing with files, but I saw that many people already use Nextcloud and OwnCloud. With Nextcloud and OwnCloud, you can do much more than files. You can also have your contacts there, your calendar. In Nextcloud, we work really hard to bring web conferencing to Nextcloud so that you can have conferences with people and one-to-one calls and stuff like this. And we want to move federated sharing also in this area. So our goal is that in the future you will also be able to share a calendar just to a different user on a different server, or an event, or you can share an address book to a different server. And of course, with the whole video conferencing at the moment, if you try it out. You can just call basically a user on the same server or a group on the same server, or you can create again some public links, you know, from WebRTC, which you send someone and then you go on the web page and then you are in the call. But there we also want to develop something where you can just say, okay, I want to call this user at this server, and then his mobile phone or his desktop client or whatever rings automatically, and he will get pulled into the call and you can have a call with him. So this was my really fast overview over federated sharing. And I'm happy to take some questions.
Yeah? Is there some formal specification for the federation protocol, or is it just de facto whatever Nextcloud, uncloud?
The question was if there's a formal specification of the protocol for the federated sharing. And yes, we started out with basically, this was a trial and error approach right at the beginning where we just implemented an own cloud and see how it works. And then it was automatically, of course, implemented Nextcloud because Nextcloud is derived from own cloud. And the Pydio people contacted us and asked how to develop this stuff. And then we helped them to implement this. As I said, it's just three or four REST calls. But we are also involved in an initiative which is called Open Cloud Mesh, which is an initiative from all the universities in Europe which use this federated sharing quite heavily. And with them we are at the moment working on a real formal specification of this protocol. So because we really want that this becomes an open standard which everybody can easily implement and set it up. So that's in ongoing at the moment. We just finished the first draft, which is now, we have now a discussion round on this draft, and we are heading into this direction.
File is shared between two servers. Is it possible to simultaneously edit with two different users?
If you have two users? At the moment, it's not possible because it's just an. The question was if you share a file from one server to another server, if it's possible to simultaneously edit a document. So basically, collaborate on this document at the same time. At the moment, this is not possible because, as I said, it's just a WebDAV mount. So the file is just mounted over there, and if people edit it at the same time, then basically the person who saved it the latest, which will store this main version, the other version will go in the versions of the file as the older versions. But with the integration, we also integrate Collabora Online Office for really collaborate on Office documents, and there we want to make it possible in the future that then you can, which already works with Collabora Office, just not in this federated sharing setup, but there we want to make it possible, of course, that you then can really collaborate on the same documents. Yeah?
Have you considered aliases for the user IDs, cloud addresses.
Aliases. Yeah, have we considered aliases for the cloud ID? And yes, we considered it. I also think that's not a bad idea. I even implemented some kind of prototype of aliases, but then people in the Nextcloud and back then it was the OwnCloud community decided that they want to have it. They thought it's too complicated, too disturbing for the normal user, whatever. So it was the consensus at the end that no, keep it simple. But I think now with the new approach that you can define your own federated cloud ID completely independent from the server, we are heading again a little bit into this direction. Of course, you don't have multiple aliases, but at least you can specify this one address the way you want to have it. Yeah?
During your talk, you spoke about C files.
Yeah, the question was, I said that I talked to C-File about implementing this federated sharing, and the question was if I talked to, because they split up recently, if I talked to the German entity or to the Chinese people. And yes, we talked with the Chinese people because I only followed this on the internet, but which was public, like probably most of us, but I have the feeling that the real development power and stuff like this is in by the Chinese people. And I think that's the people who drive it forward, and I talked with them about it. Yeah?
Talking about split and forks, what about OnCloud and Nextcloud? If you today have to give to make an argument about you should choose this solution rather than this one, what would be your argument?
My argument, I mean, we are in first, and we are all free and open source software developer. Yeah. And my main argument would be Nextcloud is completely free software.
Can you
yeah, the question was if I would make need to make an argument whether you should choose OwnCloud or Nextcloud, because I mentioned both and I worked at both companies. And so yes, as I said, because we are at Foster, we are all free and open source developers or interested in this topic, my main argument to this group would be I would choose Nextcloud because it's completely free software. If you look at OwnCloud, this has some kind of open core business model. There's this community version, which is open source and free software. But there's also then the enterprise version, which is no longer free software, which has a commercial license attached, which also has functionality, which is not available in the community version. So to this group, this would be my main argument. This is the complete free software solutions driven by the community and with the community together. OK?
Time is up now. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.